Recorded Books presents Something Myth Inc. by Robert Asprin, narrated by Noah Michael Levine.
Prologue. Like wildfire, word spread throughout the land, from town to village, from peddler to peasant, that their once idyllic kingdom was now under the control of a mighty magician who held the queen in thrall. Though it was customary for the common folk to pay little attention to who it was that ruled them, much less the antics and machinations of palace politics, this time it was different. It was clear to even a casual observer that the magician dabbled in the black arts. He openly associated with and sought counsel from demons, who even now roamed the corridors of the palace. As further evidence of his otherworldly nature and preferences, the magician kept a fierce dragon as a pet, a rarity that even the animal-loving ecologists of the land found disquieting. For those who would scoff at the existence of magic and other supernatural powers, there were frightening rumors of another sort. It was said that the so-called magician was connected to the criminal underground, trading political influence for their assistance in keeping the populace under control. Even considering all this, the people might have been willing to ignore the power shift were it not for one thing. Their taxes were being raised. While it was true that, even with the new increases, their taxes were barely half of what they had once been, the populace saw it as a grim foreboding of things to come. Once the magician succeeded in reversing the trend from lowering taxes to increasing them, it was asked, where would it stop? Clearly, something would have to be done. People who had never thought of themselves as heroes began to ponder and mutter, both singly and in groups, about ways to bring down the tyrant. Though they varied greatly in both skills and intelligence, the sheer volume of the plotters virtually ensured the eventual downfall of the villain currently growing fat off the kingdom. The man they called Skeeve the Great.
Chapter 1.
If there is one thing that a background as a mob rough-off artist does not prepare you for, it is conducting a democratic-type business meeting. Business meetings in the mob is usually conducted with as few participants as possible to keep the potential witness count to a minimum, and the agenda consists of outlining a situation in as little detail as possible and ending with the simple instruction of handle it. Having to utilize one's people-type skills to obtain opinions and input from the other participants is as unlikely as having to conduct a press conference. Still, this was a specific situation I found myself in, and was determined to do the best I could with what little training I had.
I assume there's some specific reason for this summoning?
That was Chumley talking. Even though he does a good job of playing dumb muscle when he's hired out as a troll, when he isn't working, he talks as good as anyone, and better than most.
Ask Guido,
Nunzio says, jerking a thumb at me.
It's his show.
Now Nunzio, in addition to being my cousin, is also my usual working partner of choice. Unfortunately, as sometimes happens even in the best of partnerships, we happen to be in disagreement as to the necessity of this meeting. As the senior partner, I have pulled rank, and the meeting is happening. As junior partner, however, Nunzio is standing on his right to being a royal pain in the butt while assisting me. Well, I says, ignoring Nunzio, since we're all here, we might as well get started.
Just a minute, Guido. Aren't we missing someone?
This is Oz piping up from where he's been leaning against the wall next to the door. Him, I've been expecting trouble from. I favor him with a level stare. If yous is referring to the boss, Oz, I am well aware that he is not present. In fact, that is one of the reasons for this meeting. You see, certain information has come to the attention of Nunzio and myself, and it is my desire to consult with all of yous as to whether it is wisest to pass said information along to the boss, or if we should simply act on it ourselves. This is, of course, the crux of the disagreement between Nunzio and myself, as, in the mob, to hold a meeting without the participation or even the knowledge of one's boss is to invite the interpretation that one is planning some kind of takeover attempt. In the mob, such activity is justification for termination of the most permanent kind. Now, knowing the boss the way I do not fear that this is a likely possibility, particularly as we are trying to figure out how to support him, not attempting any kind of power play. The truth of it is, we is quite fond of the boss and have prospered individually since having been assigned to him. Nunzio, on the other hand, maintains that the boss is at least technically a mob sub-chieftain, and that calling this meeting is therefore treading on even thinner ice than some of the capers we have taken part in since joining the boss's crew. At least then, he says, we could claim that we was acting under orders from the boss. This meeting is definitely my own idea, and as such, I will be held personally responsible for any fallout which might occur from it. There are times when being an order-taking goon, and therefore low on the chain of accountability, has its advantages.
Let him talk, Oz. I, for one, want to hear what he has to say.
That is Masha talking, earning her one of my widest smiles for her support, which she returns with a wink. Oz starts to say something, then just shrugs and gestures for me to start. Okay, I says. Now, you all know that during our recent assignment to stop or curtail the expansionist-type efforts of Queen Hemlock, Nunzio and me stood duty for a while as army types. Well, it seems that Hugh Badaxe's scouts have uncovered some news that affects the boss. Not wanting to take official action or use official channels, he looked up one of the squad that was serving under Nunzio and me and sent them here to pass the word along to us. I turn and wave a hand at the figure lounging against the wall behind me. This is Spider. I guess you'd call her an old army buddy of mine. Spider, I'd like you to tell the crew what you told Nunzio and me. Now, Spider was probably the toughest member of our squad after Nunzio and me. She is whipcord lean with the grace of an alley cat and twice the attitude. Due to army regulations, her short hair is now a uniform light brown instead of the rainbow of colors it was when she enlisted. This has not, however, made her look any the more military or otherwise domesticated. She continues to give the impression of being an overage gutter punk ready to fight and half looking for it, which is exactly what she is. She has been studying the assemblage as they came in like a store security type during the holidays. As I feed her the cue, like, she cranks her cat eyes around to look at me direct.
I don't think so,
she says, shaking her head. Spider, I says, trying to keep my voice level, this is not the time to get cute. I told you I wanted you to talk to these folks. Now tell them what you Bad Axe told you.
You said you wanted me to talk to some friends of yours, Swatter,
she snarls,
and I agreed. Didn't even say boo about us meeting in a stable. But who are these people? The big hairy guy with the different size eyes and the two with the green scales and the pointed ears. You can't tell me they're from around here. And unless I gone completely around the bend, that is definitely a dragon listening in from that stall. I want to know whom I'm talking to before I open up. I know you and Nunzio, but these people...
She shakes her head again and lapses into a sudden silence. What's with the swatter bit, Guido? Masha asks. It's an old army nickname, I says, waving her off. My attention is focused on my cousin. Nunzio, I thought you explained things to the squad back when we was hanged together at Abdul's.
You said to explain about Abdul being at the veal,
he says with a shrug.
I told him that our work with the boss had involved traveling to other worlds and dealing with strange creatures, and occasionally some of those creatures popped up here in our world. I also said that they could be tricky or nasty or both, and if any showed up, like Frumple, to let us handle them.
"That's it?" I says. "You didn't tell him anything about dimensions or dimension travelers?"
"At the time, that seemed more information than was necessary,"
he says.
"They accepted it."
I am finding this hard to believe, especially as Nunzio is usually one who loves to go on endlessly about anything at the drop of a straight line. "Well," I says, "that was then, and this is now. Perhaps you could elaborate a bit for Spider's benefit, with particular attention to the players currently in the room."
"No problem,"
he says, and turns to Spider.
"You see, those worlds I mentioned before are actually called dimensions. There are thousands of them out there, and the beings that live in them do so, for the most part, without any knowledge or awareness of the other dimension's existence, except, perhaps, for occasional legends or folk tales. A few, however, are not only aware of other dimensions, but often travel back and forth between them either as part of their work or simply adventuring. These dimension travelers are generally referred to as demons when they're in a dimension other than their own."
He paused and cocked his head at her, quizzical-like, but Spider just keeps staring at him.
"Now, the group assembled here," he continues, "is known in some worlds as Myth Inc. We've joined together to provide services to individuals or groups who require assistance of an unusual nature or capacity. Our leader, or chairman of the board, is the boss, or more commonly, Skeeve. You know him, or have heard of him as Skeeve the Great, currently serving as royal magician to the court apostledom. The green, scaly gent with the impressive teeth and the dour expression is Oz. He was Skeeve's main instructor in magic and things dimensional, and is currently the boss's main advisor and second-in-command. He hails from the dimension Perv, which also makes him a pervect, as is his cousin Pookie, the lean, mean, feminine version over there, who has recently joined our ranks to assist Guido and I with our bodyguarding duties."
Those two individuals incline their head politely to Spider, who nods back.
"The large, hairy gentleman is Chumley. He and his sister Tananda, who is currently covering our home office, are from Trollia. As you might guess, he would be what you might have heard referred to as a troll."
Chumley gives Spider a deep bow. I notice with some approval how quickly Nunzio skips past the reference to Tananda. She and Spider met briefly on our last assignment, but Tananda was disguised at the time, so Spider didn't spot her as a demon. The two of them didn't really get along, as they were both interested in the same man, so Nunzio is wise not to dwell on the subject.
"Last, but certainly not least, is Masha. As you can see, it's hard to miss her, both due to her larger-than-life size and a propensity for bright outfits and jewelry. She and the boss met on a caper in the dimension Jock, and she was impressed enough to sign on as his apprentice. Within our crew, however, she is a full-fledged member."
"Hiya, sugar,"
Masha says, wiggling her fingers at Spider. "Don't worry, we're not nearly as nasty as we look." Spider is so busy staring at Masha she forgets to nod. This is not surprising, as Masha is quite an eyeful. Nunzio's statement that she is larger than life does not begin to encompass her stature. Masha is huge, in all directions except up. What's more, her bright orange hair and green lipstick are upstaged by her loud, flashy clothes and enough jewelry to stock a small craft show.
"The other member of our troop is Bunny, who isn't with us at the moment because she's meeting with Skeeve to go over the kingdom's finances. Like Guido and me, she's from this dimension, which is known elsewhere as Claw, incidentally, so there's nothing unusual about her appearance other than she's cute as a button."
He notices Spider making a face at this, so he adds,
"It might also be worth noting that she is the niece of Don Bruce, the fairy godfather of the mob locally. Speaking of which, you should also probably know that as far as Don Bruce is concerned, our whole operation is a part of the mob, an independent standalone part, but a part nonetheless."
asleep.
Oh, yeah,
Nunzio says, pointing at the contributing party.
The aforementioned dragon is Gleep. He is the boss's pet and has assisted us on several capers, much to the dismay and demolition of our opponents. Does that satisfy your curiosity, Spider?
He has not bothered to include either himself or me in the instructions, since, as was earlier noted, we have worked with Spider before during our brief hitch in the army. Of course, our own appearance is no less memorable than the rest of the team. We both have the size and build of professional athletes of the contact sport variety, only more intimidating. This was pretty much a prerequisite in our earlier work as mob collection specialists.
I guess. At least explains a few things,
Spider says, coming off the wall at last. Then, returning to the point of this meeting, I says, could you now tell everyone what Hugh Badaxe asked you to pass along?
If you say so,
she says with a shrug.
Basically, General Badaxe has been getting reports of pockets of malcontents are forming in the kingdom. Right now they're small and mostly talking, but he's concerned that they might eventually try taking action, specifically armed, organized action.
Pardon me, my dear, says Chumley, but I'm afraid I'm missing something here. Why is you having you tell us about this? If there's a possible rebellion shaping up, why doesn't he simply handle it with the army?
I'm getting it at,
Spider waves.
You see, it's not the kingdom they're talking about overthrowing. It's the magician, the great Skeeve, the boss, as you call him.
How's that again?
Oz is no longer leaning against the wall, but standing tall and looking very attentive.
Well, it seemed the word going around the kingdom is that an evil magician, that Skeeve, has a queen in thrall and is actually running the kingdom from behind the scenes,
Spider explains.
While most folks don't seem to care much one way or the other, there are those who are talking about trying to, how do they put it, free the kingdom from his merciless grasp.
But that's patently absurd,
Chumley says with a frown.
We all know Skeeve. He's got a good head on his shoulders and shows marked potential as a magician, but mostly he's an organizer. There isn't an evil bone in his body.
I'll tell you something else, Missy, Masha puts in. Skeeve is helping to bail out the kingdom at Queen Hemlock's personal request. She's the one who's trying to blackmail him into marrying her. How does that fit in with your magician holding the queen in thrall scenario? For a second, I am afraid that Spider is going to go after Masha for the Missy comment, but she doesn't. This is a good thing, as Masha not only outweighs her on a factor of 5 or 6 to 1, but also packs a mean magical wallop in some of the jewelry she wears.
That's how you all see him,
Spider says,
and I'm inclined to believe you, mostly because I trust the Swatter and Nunzio. You've got to look at it through outsider's eyes to understand what's going on. Skeeve definitely has the queen's ear, that much you admit. Then there's the rumor that he consorts with strange otherworldly creatures.
She pauses and looks pointedly around the room.
And some say he's guarded by a ferocious dragon.
She nods towards Gleep, who cocks his head at her.
And finally, there's persistent talk that he has underworld connections and is supported by local organized crime.
She pointedly does not look at Nunzio and me, but the message gets across.
Not to offend your current company, but the citizens are thinking that if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck...
She lets the sentence trail off.
Anyway, whatever the truth is, that's what the talk is going on around the kingdom. General Badaxe thought you should know.
I let the silence drag on for a few minutes as the team digests what they've heard. Thank you, Spider, I says at last. I guess the big question and the reason I called this meeting is, what are we going to do about all this?
I think you were right, Guido,
Oz says,
both for calling the meeting and for thinking that it's best if Skeeve didn't hear about this.
I'll have to second that,
Chumley says.
The lad's never been particularly good at handling women, and this thing with Queen Hemlock has him tied up in knots. I say let's look into this ourselves and let Skeeve focus on his other problems.
Right,
says Oz.
particularly since this might get a bit messy, and Skeeve has always had a bit of a weak stomach when it comes to out-and-out violence, however necessary.
He looks around the assemblage and receives a round of nods. I am glad to see him taking command of the meeting, since this now gets me off the hook.
Okay, he says. Here's how I see it. For the time being, I think most of us should hang tight here at the palace to keep an eye on Skeeve, and be sure nobody tries a sneak attack or assassination. Guido, I think you and Nunzio should do some scouting to see exactly what the situation is and what we can do about it. Maybe you can figure out a way to rig it so Spider here gets assigned to assist you.
So much for getting off the hook.
I think I'd like to tag along on that as well, if nobody minds.
Pookie says, speaking up for the first time.
If you can handle the disguise spell so you don't scare the populace, I don't see why not.
Oz nods.
Okay, if everyone agrees and there's nothing else right now, I suggest we break this up and get back to what we were doing before Skeeve comes looking for us.
As the various players start to wander off, Oz draws me to one side.
Just one thing, Guido,
he says.
If you have to call another one of these meetings, I suggest you do it somewhere other than the stables. Skeeve has a habit of dropping by here from time to time to talk to his dragon.
My glance over at Gleep. Instead of his usual playing around, he is sitting very still and staring off into the distance, just as if he were thinking hard about something.
Chapter 2. Our intrepid band of adventurers has raised an excellent point. To wit, who could possibly be upset enough with Skeeve to try to organize a resistance movement? A quick glance around the kingdom, it's not that big a kingdom, yields the answer. Open rebellion rarely, if ever, comes from the rich. Their weapon of choice is money. That's why they're rich. Rather than swords and bows. What's more, they can afford to employ expert retainers to do their fighting for them. Of course, those skirmishes usually take place in court or with auditors rather than on the field of battle. By similar logic, the poor are seldom the ones to stir up trouble. Frankly, they can't afford either the time or the money it takes. Peasants are kept too busy by the endless tasks involved in tending fields and livestock to meddle openly in politics. And even begging takes a surprising amount of time and energy just to raise sufficient coins for one or two days' worth of sustenance. As long as things don't deteriorate to a point where everyone is starving and they have nothing to lose, the poor don't really care much who's running things. For real grumblers and agitators, one need only look to those who have some money, a bit of education, and too much leisure time, which is to say, the middle class. For an example of this, one need look no further than the annual gathering of the Sherwood Arms Bow Hunting Club. In happier times, this was simply a group of buddies who happened to live in the same suburb, specifically the Sherwood Arms, that scheduled their vacations at the same time so that they could all go bow hunting in the nearby Postleton Royal Game Preserve. In truth, this time was usually spent drinking and playing cards while letting their beards grow out, all in the name of roughing it, which in itself was no small achievement, considering the rather primitive conditions prevalent in Postleton at this time. This year, however, there was a markedly different air to the proceedings.
"I still don't get it,"
Tucker said, helping himself to some more wine.
"Why do we have to do anything about this Skeeve character?"
"Haven't you been listening to Rob?"
put in John, the broad-shouldered construction worker type of the group.
"He's raising taxes. You know who that's going to hit the hardest, don't you? Small businessmen like us."
"Speak for yourself, Johnny,"
Tucker snorted. He was the physical opposite of John, being rather short and rotund.
"Unlike some, I wouldn't exactly call my business little. Excuse me, small."
"Would you like to step outside and say that, Tuck?"
John said, getting to his feet and straightening to his full, considerable height.
Johnny, we are outside.
Tucker said wearily, making no effort to match John's actions. Even though they were good friends and neighbors, the big-slash-little thing was a sore spot between the two men. Tucker owned several franchises of the biggest fast food chain in Basseltom, making him notably more successful than John, whose third attempt at starting a company, this one renting porta potties, was still struggling for life.
"Could you two knock it off for a while?"
said Rob impatiently.
"This is important."
"Sorry, Rob,"
John said, sinking back into a sitting position.
"It's just that the cholesterol king here gets under my skin from time to time."
"It's just that some of us have the sense to give the people what they want, like ready-cooked food,"
Tucker sniffed.
"Why try to rent porta-potties in a country where most folks' idea of a toilet is the nearest tree or bush?"
"For the same reason that some people don't eat at your grease holes,"
John shot back.
"They appreciate sanitation."
"Sanitation, is it?"
Tucker snarled.
"Well, let me tell you..." "Enough!"
Rob interrupted.
"Do you want to hear this or not?"
The two combatants sank into a sullen silence, shooting each other occasional dark glances. Even though Rob did not have John's height and muscles, there was an intensity about him that made him the automatic leader of the group.
"Now, the part that really worries me,"
Rob continued,
"is that not only is this Skeeve character raising the taxes, he's diverting part of the army to collect back taxes as well. Tell me that doesn't affect all of us."
The group exchanged uncomfortable looks. While all of them filed their taxes on a regular basis to avoid penalties and interest, they had gotten in the habit of relying on the kingdom's laxness in collecting monies owed. As a result, they all had sizable sums owed in back taxes, which would be disastrous if said sums were to be forcibly collected all at once.
"Okay, I'll admit that could be bad,"
said the well-dressed red-headed member leaning against a tree. Slender to the point of being waspish, he nonetheless habitually carried himself with a poise and dignity that forbade anyone from even thinking of him as red.
"So what were we supposed to do about it?"
Rob craned his neck and looked around before he spoke, as if expecting to find a spy or a soldier lurking behind a nearby bush.
"I've got a plan," he said, lowering his voice. "The way I have it figured is that we can pay our taxes like good citizens, then steal it back from the collectors after they leave."
"That's illegal," the redhead said.
"If we got caught, my law practice would go right down the toilet. No offense, John. I don't like taxes any more than anyone else, but I can't see becoming a hoodlum over it." "Don't give me your legalistics, Will, and don't call me a hood,"
said Rob.
"At worst, we'd be outlaws. For that matter, we're already outside the law. We've been poaching in the Royal Game Preserve for years now."
"Nobody cares about that," Will said.
"Roderick wasn't into hunting the way his father was, and Hemlock has been too busy expanding the borders to bother with minor domestic crimes. If we start messing with the tax collectors, though, somebody's going to be upset."
"Besides, how long has it been since any of us have actually shot anything on one of these jaunts?"
Tucker murmured.
"Like we could hit something if we tried,"
John agreed. Despite their claims to being a bow hunting club, the group, without exception, were incredibly bad shots with a bow and arrow.
What's the rest of it, Rob?"
That was Allie speaking for the first time. As someone who was trying to make it as a stand-up comic and merely renting a room in John's house, he was not really a full-fledged member of the crew, but they kept him around for laughs.
"How's that again, Allie?"
Rob said innocently.
Come on, Rob,"
Allie said.
"Don't try to kid a kidder. I got to know you pretty well. Taxes and back taxes are one thing, something everyone can agree on. If I know you, though, there's something else. Something's bothering you. It's big enough to have you thinking about taking on the army, even small units of it, but isn't so big that you can use it as a sales point to the rest of us. I'm just kind of curious as to what that something is."
All eyes turned to Rob.
Okay, he said with a sigh. I've heard that one of the things Skeeve is thinking of doing is wiping out the Royal Game Preserve. It's been proposed to him that he can raise money for the kingdom if he lets the lumber companies level the forest, then sell the land to developers.
Where did you hear that from?
Said Tucker.
From my niece, Marianne. She works part-time as a maid at the castle.
A maid? Named Marianne?
John said thoughtfully.
Forget it, Johnny.
Rob waved.
Between her job and her schoolwork, she hasn't got any time to be a part of this.
I'm missing something here,
said Will.
Since we don't really do any hunting, why should it matter to us if they level the preserve?
Think about it, all of you,
Rob said.
The preserve and our hunting are the only excuses we have for these yearly outings. If it goes away, so does our excuse for getting out of the house. How many of you would really rather spend that time with your families?
A thoughtful silence descended on the assembly. Despite their personal differences, the one thing that united the men was that they were all married. Happily married, of course, but it's been said that a man can only take so much happiness without a break.
So, Rob, Tucker said, breaking the silence,
tell us more about this plan of yours.
Of course, for hotbeds of sedition and revolution, one need look no further than institutes of higher education. Rampant idealism, untempered by the practicalities of having to earn a living, is great for producing droves of untested youths who are convinced they know how to run the world better than those currently in charge. It has been noted, however, that the atmosphere of these centers tends to go through cycles, penduluming from radical to conservative and back again. At the time of our tale, the schools are in a conservative loop, so only one group of misfits figures into the current equation. The particular group under study is a gaggle of students who periodically gather to play a popular fantasy role-playing game. For those of you unfamiliar with this pastime, this is a game where people get together, often dressed up in medieval garb, to assume the role of various fantasy characters in order to act out, usually verbally, a scenario devised by the game master.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.